We didn't come into this life to do yoga. We came into this life to live joy. Animals know this. Children know this. We forget it. I started teaching yoga in the middle of the war for food. I was hungry. I got to a point where I was at one point really starving, and there was no food, and I was teaching, so they gave me food. It was a circuitous route that led me to yoga. I got very sick. I had tumors in my body, and I went to different factions of the medical profession, and they all said it was psychosomatic, that there was nothing they could do for these tumors. There were lots of different treatments to appease them, but nothing that they could actually do. I was in a terrible state. My life was not worth living. And finally I heard of these Tibetan healers, and they used Tibetan yoga and the therapy, which would actually apparently access the information of my body. The body is a barometer. It records the events of our lives, the good things and the bad things. Half of me is a scientist, and this sounded like the biggest load of bullshit that I've ever heard in my life, that my body would absorb memories. It didn't seem to be possible in the education that I'd had and the ideas that I have about the human body at that time. In some way, we push this down inside of ourselves, and we push it down and we think, oh, it's gone. But it hasn't. It's gone somewhere in the body. The body literally stores up these memories. Yeah.
As you sit up again, an even deeper breath, immediately draw the breath in. Lift it up into the chest, lift it up into the shoulders, full lung capacity, hold in the breath, chin comes down.
After I got a clean bill of health, I then studied yoga. I tried everything metaphysical I could grab my hands onto, from fire walking to isolation tanks, sweat lodges, fasting, meditations, a lot of mystical practices too, Tibetan mystical practices, out of body and in-body experiences. everything that I could access to find out about the mystery. For me, life lays within the mystery. It's not where we think it is. It's inside of us. Iyengar was my first teacher, then went to Shivananda, Hatha, Ashtanga, Mridu, Vini, Krishnamacharya, Vini Yoga was for me, and Desikachar, I think one of the most intelligent roots that I found within yoga. And that led me again to a circuitous route to my last master, Clara Buck. God bless her.
Don't be worried about it. It's okay. It's going to be fine. Okay? Have a go.
So I went to see this woman, and I went, and it was in London near where I live, and I knocked on the door, and a little old lady opened the door. She's a white-haired little old lady. She's Hungarian. And she says, oh, darling, come in. And I'm thinking, what the hell am I doing here with this little old lady? I thought there'd be some great master, and I had some concept of this master. Anyway, this little old lady takes me into the lounge, and it's full of Hungarian painted eggs and lovely little paintings everywhere. And she says, so, what do you drink? I said, I don't drink, I'm a yogi. She says, but you're Russian, my darling. You must drink something. I said, because I'm Russian doesn't mean I have to drink. So she says, well, I'm going to have a palinka. She says, would you have me drink alone? So I said, okay, no, okay, I'll have a drink with you. So she says, oh, good. So she pours out this drink, and it looks like petrol. I don't know if any of you guys have ever had palinka, but it's almost 90% proof. And you can pickle anything and it'll stay preserved in it for years. Literally, it's unbelievable. And it has some fumes that come off it. So she gave it to me and she says, I was about to drink some of it. She says, no. Smell it, darling, smell it. Smell the pears, can you smell? It's beautiful, it fills your head with perfume. And I thought, this woman's insane. She's a mad woman, you know. And so we started to sip it. And as I took 3 or 4 sips, I could feel from my waist downwards it become anesthetized. You know, I couldn't feel my legs anymore. It's this powerful. And then she looked at me with her big Hungarian eyes and she says, you see, darling, she says, yoga's my life, but it's not all of my life. I am a full human being. And I thought, you know, I think I've met my master.
At this beautiful ceiling above us that was hand-painted in white matte paint, and breathing into that. Good. Now, getting conscious of the lower back, contract the lower back and lift the body up, feeding the muscles of the lower back.
She told me that yoga is one part. It's a tool in which you live your life by. And if it doesn't make you happy, if it doesn't make your life more compassionate, more wonderful, more joyful, it's a stupid thing you do. What you do is stupid. If you can put your leg around the back of your neck and you can torture your body into all sorts of positions, what does it mean if you're not, from this, happy as a result? Then what you're doing is just from your ego and it serves nothing.
And as you lay there, just let your leg condition and just notice how the leg feels. And you gotta feel, I mean, what do you feel about this leg?
My path in yoga was to follow what I felt, and Clara would say, live your truth, be your truth. And I remember I was asked by a confederation of teachers to demonstrate what I call micro movements. In the yoga that I teach, I ask people to shift and move, like I'm shifting in this chair to feel comfortable. So people shift within postures to feel comfortable, to find where their physicality is, where they are, because we're genetically, racially, in every way we're different. So your body is different from everybody else's on the planet. And so you can't really, truly systemize yoga. You can have an attempt at it, but you can't really do it. And to really find out where you are is a discovery. And so my yoga is very exploratory and I get people to explore their bodies. And before I taught these teachers, I was very nervous. I felt like I was throwing away all my formal teaching. And I remember talking to Clara about it and she said, dare to be who you are. Dare to be who you are. And that was all I needed to hear.
Builders, politicians, all of that stuff. Breathe, let it go, breath. Let it go, breathe. Faster.
Actually, I was running a restaurant in London, which was one of the oldest vegetarian restaurants in London called Manor Restaurant. And I used to make food for people like Tina Turner, Boy George, Robert Plant, and lots of celebrities, because there's lots of recording studios around there. But I was with the wrong relationship, in the wrong job, and I knew I'd painted myself into a corner, literally, in my life. So I remember one time it was a full moon, and I looked at the full moon, and I said, if there's anybody up there, if there's anyone there, please let me out of this. And the next day, a guy came into the restaurant and said, there's a job going in Yugoslavia, in Belgrade, to run a radio station. And it's £1,000 in your hand and £600 a week, and it's rent-free and it's beautiful. And I said to him, you must be out of your mind. I mean, why would I go to Yugoslavia? I mean, there's a war just started. It's 1990 and the war is just beginning. I mean, let's go to Libya and do a radio station with Gaddafi. And, you know, how stupid is this, you know? And then as I was making the food, I was thinking, you know, I asked for this. Maybe I should think about it. And the more I thought about it, the more I thought it could be a great adventure. And I eventually said yes, and I went. And my whole life changed. It literally changed overnight. And I fell in love with the Serbian people. I met a girl out there, and we became very close. And the radio was amazing. It was an amazing experience. And my boss, Dragan Radonic, great gospodine Dragan Radonjić. He became a great master to me. He was a great mafia boss. I always thought my masters would be Indian or Tibetan, and a lot of them were. But this one was a Serbian mafia leader. He would say stuff to me like, you have to know the darkest place in yourself, the most evil place inside of yourself. You must know this place and you must touch it, but you never use it. When you know this place, you have full power. You never touch it, but you know where it is. Where is this dark place in you? And you never touch it. Then you are a complete human being. And he was amazing. He died from emphysema. He was smoking. And he was in the military hospital, and he was dying from water in his lungs. And I phoned him, and I said, Dragan, why don't you stop smoking? He says, if Dragan stops smoking, Dragan is no longer Dragan. That was it.
It looks like the first leg, but it's different. It's the other leg.
He was a great, great being. And there are many great beings who you meet along the way. And these aren't people who we call gurus. They're not the people who are popularly known. You just have to recognize them when they come along.
All the legs release all the muscular tension. Become aware of the hips pressing down to the floor. Become aware of that. Notice your belly rising and falling like the ocean.
In war, you take as many drugs and as much booze as you can, because the war is so frightening, it's so heavy. And I don't take anything, I just do the yoga. The yoga is my addiction. And some soldier saw me practicing one day and said, what is this? And I was practicing with James Brown, and all hell is going on around me. And they're standing there with Kalashnikovs, and they said, I'm doing yoga. They said, why you do this? I said, because I feel good. They said, okay, we try. So they started to do it with me, and it started to catch.
At that point, again, big movement, big breath. So again, this little movement action.
If you're intelligent, you can do many things. And I've been a dilettante all my life. I've done many, many things. It's easy for me to make money. But to do one thing that you love, and yoga was always the thing closest to my heart, and I needed a war in order to kick it into my head that this is what I actually enjoy doing. This is my path. I remember saying to myself, if I get out of this war alive, all I'm going to do is teach yoga. And when I came back to England, the yoga community literally ostracized me. They didn't want to, they said, oh, don't go to his classes. This man's a lunatic. He uses movement. He breaks all the traditions. He's broken 5,000 years of tradition in his class. I mean, this was my big claim to fame, that I had broken 5,000 years of tradition. I had a headline in the paper about it. And but all the clubbers would come to my class. All people who would never do yoga would come to my class because they loved the music. They thought it was cool. So my classes were full.
Totally and completely rest the body. Shavasana, the death posture.
It's like when you go fishing. I used to go fishing with my dad. And when we go fishing, you're on a boat, and we used to go trout fishing. And the fish come up in the water. And when the sun goes down, the fish come up to the surface. And they come here and here, and you want to fish for this one, you want to fish for that one. And my father says, don't fish for the ones you can see. Fish straight ahead. The big ones lay underneath the water, you never see them. That's the ones you go for. Just go straight ahead with your life. Go straight ahead. Don't look to this side or that side. Straight ahead. Have your vision, straight ahead. And for a long time, you can't see anything. It doesn't matter. Go straight ahead. Keep the vision inside of yourself. And that's what I did. And finally, the word got around, and that what I was doing was good, and people started to come, and teachers would come. Yoga survived for 7,000 years, and it only survived because it gets you high. The reason yoga has survived that long is because we literally become high. We change our chemistry. And I know that I can change my chemistry simply by breathing and stretching, by sleeping, whatever it is. I can do it with recreational drugs, but I don't need to do it because I have all the drugs that I ever need in my body. This is the perfect pharmacy, and it comes with the right dosage on the bottles, already printed inside of me. All I need to do is be able to access and press those points in my body and know how to do it. And what I teach is how to do it.